Experiment 23 in Chem 1212 is titled Fundamentals of Electrochemistry. And in this experiment, you'll come face to face with some of the characteristics and applications of electron transfer or redox reactions, which actually involve the transfer or the movement of an electron from one reagent that we call the reductant to another that we call the oxidant. If you separate the reductant and the oxidant in space, so that electron transfer has to occur over a macroscopic distance, you can actually cause electrons to move over a distance, and we call that current. So we can actually use spontaneous redox reactions to create electric potential energy differences and drive currents, and this is the basis of batteries. So in this lab, you'll see one of the earliest examples of a battery, and you'll construct various half cells and connect them together to create galvanic cells. We'll also use electrical energy to drive a reaction forward. That's known as electrolysis, and we'll see a basic redox reaction in action. So in this video, I'm going to introduce you to a little bit of the theory and some of the experimental pointers for experiment 23. So what you see here is a general redox reaction between R and O plus to form R plus and O. Now, if you really look at this process, you'll notice that R and O haven't changed. All that's really changed is the formal charges on these species. So we can think of this process as the transfer of a negatively charged electron from R to O+. Notice that R goes from neutral to positively charged. It's lost a negative charge. And O+ goes from O+ to neutral O, so it's actually picked up an electron. So these two changes taken together represent the transfer or the movement of an electron from R to O+. Kind of along the same way that an acid-base reaction involves the transfer of a proton, redox reactions involve the transfer of one or more electrons, and the effect overall is a transfer of negative charge. We can sort of think of two different things going on here. R is losing an electron, it's giving up an electron, and O plus is receiving or gaining an electron. You've probably heard the famous adage or mnemonic, Leo says Gr, and that's applicable here. Losing electrons is oxidation, so R is being oxidized. Gaining electrons is reduction. O plus is gaining an electron. That's reduction. Now, because R is the reagent that's donating an electron to O plus, one name that you'll hear for R is the reducing agent or reductant. It's doing the reducing. O is the species being reduced, but the thing that is doing that is the reagent R, so it's called the reductant. Now, another way to think about it from the perspective of O plus is O plus is a species that's receiving or that's pulling electrons from R. So in that sense, O plus is what we call an oxidant or an oxidizing agent. It's inducing the oxidation of R. You'll see these terms come up in redox reactions. In the first part of experiment 23, we'll be looking at a spontaneous redox reaction just occurring in solution. The specific reaction, which is a good example of this general paradigm, is two aluminum metal atoms react with three copper 2 plus ions to form two aluminum 3 plus ions and three equivalents of copper metal. On the whole, this represents the transfer of six electrons from the neutral aluminum to the copper 2 plus. Note the overall formal charge on each side of the equation. We have six positive charges on the left, right? Three copper 2 plus ions. And we have six positive charges on the right, two aluminum 3 plus ions. So on the whole, six electrons are transferred in this redox reaction. What you'll actually observe in the lab is you'll take a solution of copper 2 plus ions, which is blue, and to that you'll add a few strips of aluminum foil. And over time, what will happen is the blue color will disappear from the solution, it will become clear, and you'll notice brown or reddish-brown copper powder start to settle out on top of the aluminum surface. So if you wait long enough, and the stoichiometry is right, eventually all of the aluminum metal will be converted to copper metal. In part A2 of experiment 23, we'll be looking at another redox reaction, another reaction that involves electron transfer. But this one is different from A1 in that it's not a spontaneous process. In other words, the left-hand side of this reaction is favored. So, and in a sense, it's a good thing it is, because iodide dissolved in water hopefully is not reactive on its own. In fact, iodide in water just sits there. If you take potassium iodide and dissolve it in water, well, it just sits there. So the left-hand side of this reaction is favored. But like all unfavorable reactions, if we add an energy source to this, we can push it to the right. So what we need is some energy source that can push this reaction toward the right-hand side. Electrical potential energy is the perfect way to do this because the reaction does actually involve the transfer of charge from one species to another. Notice that we start with iodide or I minus on the left-hand side and we end up with hydroxide or OH minus on the right. So electron transfer is happening, and electrical energy sources like a battery or a power source or an outlet can be used to actually drive this redox reaction forward. The experimental setup is relatively simple and looks something like this. We start with a beaker of that potassium iodide solution, and into it we stick two wires. These are what you'll call graphite electrodes. They're pencils that are just connected to a battery, and we'll use a battery as the current source, as the energy source for this reaction. So over time, as the battery injects and pushes electrons through the solution, electron transfer will occur, and we'll push it to the right-hand side. Now, two questions I want you to think about in relation to this process that'll be important for the lab. The first is, how will the concentration of hydroxide change as the reaction proceeds to the right? And that's pretty apparent from the chemical equation that you see. And how are we going to measure the hydroxide concentration at the beginning and the end of this process? And what does that measurement tell us about how far the reaction has gone, how much iodine we've made, how much iodide we've consumed, and how effective the power source is at actually driving the reaction forward? To begin discussing part B of this experiment, I want you to consider the redox reaction shown here. 1 mole of zinc metal reacts with 1 mole of copper 2 plus ions to form 1 mole of zinc 2 plus ions and 1 mole of copper metal. As we can see by examining the formal charges on either side, this reaction represents the flow of 2 electrons per atom of zinc or atom of copper 2+ from the zinc metal to the copper 2+. Now I want you to imagine what would happen if we took a really, really, really tiny light bulb and we inserted it right at the place where the zinc was transferring the electrons to the copper 2+. The electrons are moving, and imagine we made them move somehow through the light bulb. Well, because electrons are moving through the light bulb would light up, right? We can actually accomplish this on a macroscopic scale using a device called a galvanic cell, which is essentially a battery. All batteries are really incarnations of galvanic cells and use the chemical energy difference associated with a spontaneous chemical reaction for electrical energy purposes. So they're all about the conversion of chemical energy, or free energy, Gibbs free energy as we would call it, to electrical energy. So how do you actually accomplish this transformation in practice of chemical to electrical energy? Well, the way to do it is to first start with a setup like this. We've got a beaker, which I've drawn in blue. We've got an aqueous solution of zinc 2 plus ions, and sitting in that is this black zinc metal electrode with a wire coming out of the top of it. We take one of those and we do the exact same thing with copper. So we have a beaker of copper 2 plus ions now on the right with a red copper metal electrode sticking in it, and we have a wire connected to that other electrode or that other setup on the left. And between them, just to see what's going on, we'll put a voltmeter. Now you could put any electrical load here, like a light bulb, to explore what's going on. We'll use a voltmeter so that we can actually get quantitative data out of this. So again, to remind you what's in here, we have a strip of zinc metal, and that's sitting in a zinc 2+ aqueous solution. And on the right, we have copper metal, and that's sitting in an aqueous solution of copper 2+ ions. Now I want you to take a minute and examine this experimental setup and ask yourself, which direction are electrons going to flow? The reaction as it's written at the top here is spontaneous. So how will electrons move? Well, electrons are going to move from the zinc to the copper 2+, right? So just thinking about where those are located in the setup, electrons are going to move from the zinc electrode on the left, the metal strip of zinc on the left, toward the copper 2+ ions that are actually in solution on the right. So electrons will move from the left to the right spontaneously in this process. So it looks like we're accomplishing our goal. We're moving electrons along that wire macroscopically through space. Unfortunately, the galvanic cell in this form won't actually work. And you can try this in the lab. See the voltage difference that you get. You'll see 0 volts if you try to test it in this form. You can appreciate the reason why if you think about what happens to charge on either side during this electron transfer process. So as we push electrons out of the left-hand side and toward the right, we're leaving positive charges on the left that are not accounted for because we're making zinc 2 plus on the left, right? So positive charge is building up on the left-hand side. On the other hand, we're converting copper 2 plus to copper metal, and there will be some counterion to the copper 2 plus on the right-hand side. That'll be an anion, and as we remove copper 2 plus ions from that solution, we'll end up with an excess of negative charge on the right. So all of a sudden, we've got positive charge on the left, negative charge on the right, and something that is huge scale. So that creates a massive electrical driving force to push electrons the other way. And this is more of a physical thing than a chemical thing per se, but as soon as just a few electrons, it doesn't take much at all, get pushed from the left to the right, there's a force that exactly balances that to push electrons back to the left. So the galvanic cell in this form won't exactly do it for us. To overcome this issue of charge buildup, what we really need is some mechanism to move charge without moving the electrons that are flowing. So we need to move charges simultaneously with the flow of electrons through the wire. So we need some other connection between the two halves of the galvanic cell. But we don't want to move electrons because then we'll be canceling out the movement of electrons through the wire. The trick is to move ions through. The trick is to move ions through, and we can do that using a device called a salt bridge. Now, salt bridge is a pretty fancy-sounding term, but all we'll really use in the laboratory is just a piece of filter paper that aqueous solution can move through. So if we can move aqueous solution along this bridge, then it will function perfectly well as a salt bridge. Now again here, I want you to think about the directions that each type of ion will move to balance the flow of electrons through this device. So take a second and think about this before continuing on. On the left-hand side, we said in the absence of the salt bridge, we had a buildup of positive charges, right? So what we're going to see is movement through the salt bridge of positive charges. Another way to think about this is that we need to move positive charges to the right to balance the negative charge that's moving as electrons move through the wire from left to right. And if we're moving positive charges from the left to the right, well, that means that we must be moving negative charges from the right to the left. And remember, these negative charges are those counter ions or counter anions of the copper 2 plus that we started with. So the movement of charges ensures that basically there will be no issue of charge balance going on with the left and the right half cells. In other words, macroscopically, the charges of the half cells will remain pretty close to zero, even though we are moving electrons through the wire. This video is getting a little long, so I won't get into the theoretical details of galvanic cells, but some things that you should appreciate about galvanic cells are, firstly, that the voltage across a galvanic cell depends on the identity of the components. So there's an intrinsic potential energy difference associated with zinc 2 plus gaining 2 electrons, reduction of zinc 2 plus, right? And there's an intrinsic energy difference associated with the reduction of copper 2 plus. And these are going to dictate the voltage that we see. The other thing that you should appreciate is that the voltage that we'll observe is going to depend on the concentrations of these ions in solution, zinc 2 plus and copper 2 plus. And this is really no different than the effects on delta G of concentrations. So just like the reaction quotient affects whether a reaction will go to the right or go to the left, the reaction quotient associated with a galvanic cell affects whether electrons will flow to the right or to the left, and what the energy difference, or what we would see as the voltage, ends up being for that process. We've all experienced a battery dying over time, and what that actually is the reaction quotient of concentrations in the battery approaching the equilibrium value or the equilibrium constant. As it gets closer and closer and closer, the change in free energy associated with moving electrons becomes closer and closer and closer to zero. And we can think of a dead battery really as a battery just at equilibrium.